Hello. Good morning, students. As we all know, to achieve mastery and command over any language, you need to understand the grammar of that language thoroughly. You would have studied different concepts of English grammar as well, like tenses, determiners, etc. And today, what we are going to discuss here is modal auxiliaries. Auxiliary verbs, you must understand, to have correct formation of grammar, and modal auxiliaries in particular will explain you not only how to read and write correct English, but also how to speak correct English. And I'm sure all of you are interested in spoken English, to improve your spoken English. Modal auxiliary students, I tell you, is a key. If you have correct knowledge of where to apply which modal auxiliary, half of your spoken English would be improved, I'm sure. So, let's discuss this very interesting topic, modal auxiliaries, today. Before we move on to what modal auxiliary is, let us understand what an auxiliary verb is. An auxiliary verb is a verb which helps or supports the main verb to form its tense, voice, or mood. Auxiliary, in simple English, you call it as helping verbs. And they are, helping verbs are divided in two categories. We have primary auxiliaries and we have modal auxiliaries as well. The primary auxiliaries include different forms of to be, which are am, is, are, was and were. You are very well aware of where to use am, is, are, was, were and how they are used as helping verbs. For example, if you say I am a student, am there is a main verb. But if you say I am playing, am there is a helping verb, and that's why it is called primary auxiliary there. Then we have different verb forms of have, that is have, has and had. You know, for perfect tenses, you require different forms of have as auxiliary verbs. And then we also have different forms of do. Do, does and did. I'm sure all of you know how to use it. If you want to make any sentence in simple present tense, a question, interrogative sentence or a negative sentence, you would require this. You can say, he goes to the park. But if you want to make the same statement a question, you need to apply does. Does he go to the park? And that is how does is helping there in sentence, and that's why it is a primary auxiliary. So basically, auxiliaries are two types, primary and modal. Primary auxiliaries include be, have and do. Different forms of all these three verbs. Fine. Then going on to next and today's topic, we have modal auxiliary verbs. Let us understand what a modal auxiliary is. Modal auxiliary verbs are used with a main verb to show mood and ideas such as ability, possibility and permission. The main modal auxiliary verbs are listed here. But before we move on to this, let me explain this. They show mood and ideas like ability, if you want to suggest your ability, or if you want to talk about the possibility of anything happening, or you want to take permission. Basically, we use all the modal auxiliaries. And which are these modal auxiliaries? These modal auxiliaries include can and could, will and would, must, ought to, shall, should, may, might, have to, and need. Basically, today we are going to discuss about all these modal auxiliaries in detail. Let's start with can. Can is a modal auxiliary and it is used, the first use of can is, it is used to express ability. When you are suggesting you are able to do it, you can say I can do it. For example, you can say Rohan can speak French, but he cannot speak German. When you are talking about Rohan's ability to speak in French, you will say Rohan can speak French. The other way you can use Rohan is able to speak French. But you don't want to use the verb able to, you can use the modal auxiliary can. So my point is basically we use can to express ability. Children, you all need to speak so many times about your own self. So many times your teacher asks you what you can do. Tell me about yourself. In all those situations, you need to talk about yourself, and that's how can would be very useful to you. I can do this, I cannot do this. Superman can do things that ordinary people can't. Ability of Superman to do things which ordinary people can't. Then the second use of can is, it is also expressed in requesting form. If you want to request somebody, for example, you want to ask for help. Can you help Suman? Can you do this for me? Can I offer you something to drink? You are indulging in a polite conversation. You are in a formal conversation and you want to express request. In all the situations, you would use can. As I told you, modal auxiliaries are useful in spoken English. You need to understand that you come across all these kind of situations in your day-to-day life wherein you are requesting somebody. In all those situations, the word that you would use is can. The next use of can, again we are continuing with can only. Can is expressed for permission. When you are giving somebody permission, then you will use can, or you want to take permission at that time also, you can use can. Can I use your cell phone? You can't go out with Viraj. You are denying a permission, you are giving a permission. For any such sort of thing, the use of can is permitted. Fine, then, and can at times also expresses possibility. If the weather is perfect tomorrow, we can go on a picnic. This is just a plan. Nothing sure about it, but we can go. Like if the time permits, if the weather is okay, we can go. I can be ready by 5. That is not before 5. You are suggesting a possibility. If you insist, I'll be ready by 5. So, when you want to speak about yourself, when you are talking about any kind of possibility of future, you can express it with the use of can. So in all, we are discussing the auxiliary can here, and we have seen can is used to express ability, then it is also used to express request, we use it to express permission, and the fourth use is to express possibility. In all these situations, use of can is done by all of us, and then you have examples with you. You can read these examples and then you can form your own sentences. Next auxiliary that we are discussing is could. What are the uses of could? Then could is used to express abilities in the past. When you are talking about something that you were able to do in the past, but now it is not possible, then you would use could. For example, Jaimin could do 50 push-ups in 5 minutes when he was young. That means the very first meaning that we draw out of this sentence is Jaimin is not able to do it today. He does not have this ability as on now in present, but we are talking of the past, and that's why Jaimin could do it. When he was young, he could do it. When you were young, you could do so many things. When you were a child, you had so much of time. So many things that you need to express your ability of the past, you would use the word could. Jason could talk when he was 4. Again, we are giving reference of past. Secondly, it is used in request to express greater politeness. When you are indulging in polite conversation, when you want to show greater politeness, you are talking to a superior, you are talking to somebody who is very higher in position to you, you would use this word. Could you help me in my assignment? So basically, when you use could, it means you are polite. So always use this. It is good. It gives good impression and it speaks of your gentlemanliness. So you can use this in different situations when you are asking for any kind of help. Then could is also used to express future possibility. It expresses more uncertainty than may, but even then we use it for future. For example, I could get an A or B in grammar. It depends on the final exam. That is, you are not at all sure about it. You are just pre-assuming it. It's not at all, you are not sure, and that is why it expresses even more uncertainty than may. It is just a possibility. You are just giving a passing remark and you can say, I could. You never know, I can do this, like that way. It is also used with present perfect tense to express something in the past that may be real. You could have been killed in that accident. That is, the things have gone, the time has gone, but you are just giving the reference of it. If this would have happened, you could have been killed in that accident. The accident was so severe, it was so major, you could have been. The possibility of past. In all such situations also, you would use could. I could have won that game. That means the game is over, the result is announced, you have lost the game, but still you are talking, had I not done this mistake, I could have won the game. If we repeat, then again, the use of could are four uses. It expresses abilities of the past. It also expresses request in when you want to be polite. It is used to express future possibility, but more uncertainty than may. And then it also expresses something that could have been real in the past. So these are the four uses of could. Fine, then. Moving on to the next auxiliary, we have shall. Shall, as we all know, it is used to denote future time with first person, singular and plural, both will take shall, that we know. For example, I shall leave for Ahmedabad tomorrow. So it is a future tense, you are giving reference of future tense and you use the word shall. It can be used for plural also. We shall apply for this exam, you can say this. So for both singular and plural, first person, you use to denote future time. But then when you use it for second and third person, it does not denote future time, but it expresses threat, command, determination and promise. For example, when you say you shall be punished if you are late again, it is not a future reference you are giving, it is a threat. You shall be punished, like it would not be tolerated anymore. You shall go out of the class. You are giving command of now, you shall go out. She shall have a prize, promise. When you are giving promise to somebody, you will use. So as simple as this, in first person, it denotes future time. In second and third person, shall expresses threat, command, determination and promise. It is also used to make suggestion and to offer service. When you are suggesting somebody, you will use shall. Shall we have a cup of coffee? Shall I carry your luggage? When you are offering somebody, when you are suggesting something, in all those situations also, you can use shall. Revising the thing, shall, it denotes future tense with first person, both singular and plural. It expresses threat, command, determination and promise in second and third person. It is used to make suggestion and to offer services in first person when you want to suggest something or when you are offering something. Fine. The next modal auxiliary that we have is will. And will is used to denote simple future tense in second and third person. As we use shall in first person to denote future, in the same way for second and third person we will use will. He will come tomorrow, simple future tense. When we want to use it, we'll use will. So remember, children, for future tense reference, in first person we will use shall, in second and third person we will use will. Then it is used to express polite request too. Will you lend me a pen, please? Just as we used could in the same reference, in the same meaning, for polite request you can use will. And when will is used to express threat, command and determination or promise in first person. I will score good marks. It is a promise. So the way we use shall in second and third person, we use will the same way in first person. It is also used to express willingness. I will come to see you tomorrow. I am willing to, I am ready to. If you want to express it this way, then also you can use it with first person. Again, talking about will, we have seen four uses of will. It denotes simple future in second and third person. It is used to express polite request also. It is used to express threat, command, determination and promise in first person. And then it is used to express willingness. The next auxiliary is would. And would is used, number one, is as the past tense of will. She said she would buy dinner on her way home. We understand that in direct to indirect speech, you need to express these kind of sentences in past tense, and would is used as past tense of will. She said she would buy. So she said, comma into inverted comma, she will buy dinner on her way home. When you are turning it into indirect, you will use would instead of will. I believed it would rain, so I brought my raincoat. I thought so in the past tense, and that's why I would use would. It is also used to express polite request. Would you please take off your coat? Would you mind turning the radio off? When you are being polite to somebody, when you are requesting somebody to suggest your politeness, to be humble, you can use this word would. Would also expresses actions that take place in the past. I would fish and swim in the river when I lived in the countryside. The way you use used to, in the same way you can use would. I would, at that time I used to do it, I would fish and swim in the river when I lived. When I was in the village, when I was living in the countryside, I would do this. That was my routine, that was my habit. When you want to express it, you can use it. And it also expresses desire. I would like to have one day off. I would love to stay for a few more days. When you want to speak about your wish, your desire, you can use would. Understanding it once again, would again, we have discussed four uses. It is used as past tense of will. It is used to express polite request. It is used to express actions that take place in the past. And it is used to express your wish or desire. The examples we have seen, the examples are written here. The next modal auxiliary that we need to see is should. We have seen shall and now we are discussing should. Should is used to give advice and opinions or to show moral obligation. When you are advising somebody, when you are talking about your duty, you should do this, you can use. You are driving too fast, you should slow down a little bit. See, there are many situations in life wherein you cannot compel anybody. What you can do is only advise. Somebody is senior to you, somebody is your friend, like you cannot command or you cannot have your will implied every time. In all those situations, you can use should. When you are suggesting somebody's duty or you are talking about advice or you are expressing your opinion. For example, you have gained a lot of weight, you should go on diet. That is, my belief is this, my opinion is this. Now I cannot compel, this is what my advice is. Should is also used to express expectations. For example, you can say, are you ready? The taxi should be here soon. That should be is, I expect the taxi to be here soon, and that's why you should be ready. $20 is enough. It shouldn't cost more than that. That is what my belief is. That is what my expectation is. So we use should in all those situations. Again, if we want to have a recap of should, it is used for advising somebody, it is used to express our opinion or our moral obligation, and it is used to express expectations as well. Next set of auxiliary that we have is must and have to. I've taken them both together because you can interchange them. They both express the same thing. That's why. They both are used to express something that is necessary and essential. They suggest compulsion. Here I do not have a choice. I have to do. When the sentence has must, that means it is compulsory. Should means it is my duty. I may do or I may not do. But must means I do not have a choice. I have to do it. For example, you must pay by cash. That is, nobody is asking me here. It is a rule. I have to pay by check. That is for sure. Like, it is compulsory. You have to drive on the right in France. Students have to wear uniform. They are not asked whether they like it or they do not like it. They have to. So, must and have to expresses compulsion. Must not is used to express something that is not permitted or allowed. In the other way, like when you are using must not, that means this is not allowed, this is prohibited here in this premises. You must not smoke, eat and drink in the museum. That is not allowed. So, in situations when you do not have choice but to obey whatever is told, you use must and have to. Must and have to are the examples, like they are the words which are used to express compulsion. Children, you need to understand should is for duty, should is for advice, but must is for compulsion. In spoken English, many times you have to give somebody command, you have to tell somebody that this is compulsory here. Here you have to do whatever is asked. In all those situations, you will use must. When you are advising somebody or when you are just talking of your own self or you are expressing your opinion, in all those situations, you will use should. Then, the next auxiliary that we need to discuss here is may. And may is used to express possibility in the present or in the future. You are talking of possibility. It may rain. Means you see clouds in the sky and you are just expressing that according to you it may rain. Because the situation is telling you that there is a possibility of rain. You are suggesting it may rain. Elizabeth may know his telephone number. This is only suggestion. This is your thinking that Elizabeth might be knowing her telephone number, and that's why you say this way. The second use of may is for asking permission. Very useful to you in spoken English. You have to ask permission to your seniors so many times, to your teachers so many times. In all those situations, you use may. For example, you use this sentence, may I come in? And you may come if you want. Like, you are giving somebody a permission. If you want to join me, you may come if you want. I am permitting you. It is also expressed to express wish or hope. Whenever we are blessing somebody, whenever we are expressing compliments to somebody, then we use may. May you live long. May God bless you, we say. May you have long life. May your dreams come true. In all such situations, when we are blessing somebody, when we are expressing wish or hope, we'll use may. So may word you must understand very well. This would be very useful when you try to practice spoken English for your fluency. In all such situations, you will use may, where you want to express possibility in the present or in the future. You want to take permission, or you want to express wish or hope. The next auxiliary is might. And might is used to express possibility in the present or in the future. But might expresses less possibility than may. So whenever there is lesser possibility, you will use this word. You might not get confused that what is the use. May and might both are to express possibility. Students, you must understand may is used when there is more possibility. Might is used when the possibility is lesser. Asha might be in the library. I am not sure. You are just giving a passing remark. You are not at all sure. You have not even seen her going to library. You just are guessing that she might be there in the library. He might come. The chance that he comes is likely than may. If you say he may come, maybe there are 50% of chance. When you are telling he might come, you are not at all sure. You are very unsure about it. You are just giving it just for the sake of it, and you are telling he might come. So might expresses possibility, but then lesser possibility than may. And it is also used with present perfect tense when you are speculating about the past. For example, Edward is late. He might have missed his bus, or he might have overslept. The situation is he is late, but you are talking about what would have happened in the past. He might have missed the bus, that's why he is late, or he might have overslept. You don't know. You are just thinking, you are speculating, you are just assuming, guessing that this might have happened, and that's why this is the situation. So many times in life, we speak about all these things, and that's why you need to understand that in such situations, when you are just guessing about somebody's behavior of past, you will use might. So might is used, again giving a recap, it is used to express possibility either in the present or in the future. And it is also used to express present perfect tense about speculation of the past. The next modal auxiliary that we discuss is need. And need is used to express necessity or obligation. When you talk of moral obligation, or when you want to speak about this is necessary for you, you must do this. And in all such situations, you use need. For example, one needs to be careful every time. This is obligation. Like it is like an advice. One needs to. We need to do this. We need to obey the traffic rules. So this is our obligation. This is our duty. We must do it. And that's why you use need. And then for necessity, the example is tomorrow is a holiday. You need not go there. There is no need. There is no necessity. When you want to express it this way, then you use need. Students, do not get confused. Need is used even as a main verb also in situations, and then as a modal auxiliary also. But as I told you, we use need as modal auxiliary in situation when it is talking about necessity or obligation. In both this situation only, we use it as modal auxiliary. The last modal auxiliary here to discuss is ought to. And ought to is similar in meaning to should, because it also indicates strong obligation or duty. When you want to say this is something which is expected out of you, or it is our duty to do it, then we use ought to. We ought to help the poor woman. We ought not to cheat in the exam. This is what, at least bare minimum, we ought not to cheat in the exam. You can also use we should not cheat in the exam. These are two different words given to you for strong obligation and duty. You can either use ought to, or you can use should. So these are all different modal auxiliaries that we have discussed. But then When we have seen each of this model auxiliary individually, then now I would like to pay attention here. I would like to explain the differences between these all these modal verbs. See, the modals used to express future possibility are may, might, could and can. In the presentation here, you would have seen for all these I have written that they are used to express future possibility. So then where to use what? Could and might express more uncertainty than may. So when you are only 10 or 20% sure, when you are just giving your assumption or a passing remark, in all those situations only you would use could and might. For better possibility, you will use may. I may take a vacation in Bali Island. You could be right, I am not sure. There are only few jobs available, so she might not find one. These are all different examples. But you need to understand these four words, may, might, could and can. Here, could and might speak of lesser possibility, more uncertainty. May speaks of more possibility. So go for may when you are a bit sure about it. Go for might and could when you are not very sure about it. Then, the modals used to express request are can, could, will and would. For gentle request, for polite request, we can use all these four modal auxiliary, can and could, will and would. However, could and would are more polite. So, you must use these two words, could and would. Do not use can I use your pen. Better usage is could I use your pen or would I use your pen. Could you give me a raise? Yes, I can. Can you close the window? Sure, I can. But then here you need to remember this. Be sure to use can and will for an affirmative short answer, even if the question starts with would and could. So you do not get confused. Even if the question is could you give me a raise and you want to speak yes, never say, yes, I could. Even the sentence is speaking of could, in answer, you will use can. The sentence speaks can, you will use as can in answer. But even if the question starts with would or could, which are used for more politeness, when you are giving answer in affirmative. Affirmative means when you are telling yes. In all these situations, use can and will for shorter answers. The modals used to express permission are can, could and may. May is used in formal situation. Better to ask use may when you are taking permission in formal situation, when you are talking to a superior and you are asking for permission. Where may I park my car? You can park right in front of the store. The basic thing I want to explain here is for asking permission, use may. For giving permission, use can. As simple as this. See, you need to remember this when you want to ask some permission, you can use may in interrogative sentence. And when you want to give permission in that situation, use can. Yes, you can. No, you can't. Could I borrow your MP3? Yes, you may. You may not park in the handicapped parking space. The whole answer, if you want to give, not so shorter one, then you can use even may. Use may and can in short answers. Could cannot be used to give and refuse permission. Yes, you could. No, you could not. This is not the right thing. Do not use could in giving and refusing permission. Use only for giving permission or for refusing permission. Better to use the words can and may. Never use the word could. Use could for asking permission, but do not use could for giving permission. The modal used to give advices are could, might, should, must, have to, had better, and ought to. All these words, could, might, should, must, have to, had better, and ought to. All these words are used to give advices. For example, you could meet me tonight or tomorrow morning. You had better tell us the truth. Yes or not to see a doctor. You should not wear sandals and shorts to work. These are all the verbs which we use in giving advice. So here I have just given you the consolidated list of that. For advice you can use these words, for permission you can use this word, for gentle request, for polite request you can use these words, for possibilities you can use these words. Then the modal used to express preferences are prefer, would rather and would like. For example, I would prefer to have Japanese food for dinner. When you are talking of your preference, when somebody has asked you what do you like more and you want to express it this way, use I would prefer. I would prefer to spend the night at home rather than drive out. Given a choice, if somebody asks me, then I would do this one. This is my wish, this is my preference. I would rather go by bus. You are talking of your own wish. So in all, we have seen all the modal auxiliaries in detail, and if we see the consolidated list once again, you need to understand that the words which we use for future possibility are may, might, can and could. Use may and can in more possibility and might and could in more uncertainty. When you are not certain, use might and could. When you are a bit sure there is a possibility of things happening, use may. Then for request, you have set of word is can, could, will and would. But then could and would are more polite, so go for these two words when you are asking somebody. Could and would. For when you are answering somebody, use the word can. Do not use the word could or would. The modals that you use for permission are can, could and may. But may generally we ask for asking permission, and can we use for giving permission. Could do not use for giving or refusing permission. For both the ways, when you are giving in short answers in short, use may and can. And then for advices, you have set of words are could, might, should, must, have to, had better, ought to. You can interchange these words. All these words are used for advices, but then the structures are different. If you are using ought, it will have an infinitive. Ought to will be used. Should will be alone. And then you have set of examples given here. In the last set of modal auxiliaries, when we use it for preferences, these words are prefer, would rather prefer, and would like to. So in all, we have discussed all the modal auxiliaries here. We have seen them individually and we have seen them separately, each one by one. We have seen their uses. You have the set of examples here with you. Do not get confused when you read this in book, and when along with the book, when you see this, you will be able to have this clear idea where you can use which words. Students, in regular day-to-day life situation, we need to express so many things. We need to ask permission. We need to give permission. We need to be gentle to people. We are giving advices to people. We are suggesting somebody something. We are giving our own opinions. We are expressing ourselves. In all these situations, the correct usage of modal auxiliary would help us. And that's why you need to prepare this topic very carefully. And I hope this presentation would help you, and it would clear all your confusion regarding the use of different modal auxiliary, as we have discussed each and every modal auxiliary in depth with example. We have seen different modal auxiliaries. We have seen their usage and in different situations how we would use which modal auxiliary. I hope your understanding is clear by now. For more practice, We'll see set of exercises in the next part of the same presentation. Thank you.